Good morning, Mr. Attorney. Can you give me your name and your date of birth, sir?
Michael R. Attorney, 219-48.
All right, and the state you want to announce?
George Kellerman for the Maricopa County Attorney's Office. Good morning, Your Honor.
Good morning, and the defense?
Good morning, Judge. Ashley Otto and Jamie Jackson on behalf of Michael Attorney.
All right. All right, so let's go ahead and go forward with this matter. All right, Mr. Attorney, you are here in response to a Superior Court grand jury warrant. The charge is as follows. It is one count, murder in the second degree, of class one felony, allegedly occurring in May 17, 2001. Mr. Jackson and Ms. Otto are here from the Public Defender's Office representing you throughout this process. Mr. Kellerman's here from the state. Right now, you have some upcoming court dates happening, but before I get into the court dates, I know that there's a question of bond, so I would like to hear from both sides of the aisle here. Mr. Kellerman, did you want to be heard on release conditions?
Yes, Your Honor. There was a grand jury warrant that was issued yesterday in the amount of $500,000 secured a third bond. Now, the state would request that bond be affirmed on the warrant.
All right, and the defense?
Thank you, Judge. Mr. Attorney is a 72-year-old disabled veteran. He was born and raised in Arizona. He has a stable place to live. Mr. Attorney suffers from a myriad of physical health issues. He requires a CPAP machine to sleep. He has blood pressure issues, heart and lung issues.
Called today, about 20 minutes ago, from Detective William Anderson of the Phoenix Police Department. And he let me know that a warrant was issued for my father's arrest, and he is now in custody and being charged with the homicide of Alyssa. This moment feels so unreal. But I wanted to come on here and say thank you to all of you, to every single person that shared this story for so many years, for listening to this podcast. Without you guys, this would have never happened. Without your support, without making this podcast successful, without you liking on social media and sharing her story and keeping this pressure on, it would have never happened. You guys are all voices for justice, and that is all I ever wanted. I cannot thank you enough. I don't have all the details right now, but once I do, I will make a longer update. But I wanted to come on here and say thank you for being my family. And thank you for caring about Alyssa as much as I do. I couldn't have gotten through this without each and every one of you. I love you guys so much. This process has been absolute hell. Absolute hell. I never ever wanted to get on media. I never wanted to make my own podcast, but we did it, you guys. I don't know what comes next, but I'll definitely let you know as soon as I find out. But thank you, and I love you, and I'll talk to you next time.
Tell me about your sister, Alyssa.
Alyssa is 4 years older than me, and she's basically the only mom I ever had. She really raised me, and she was the sweetest and the strongest girl I've ever met. She definitely is the source of all of my strength.
Sarah and Alyssa lost their mother when they were very young. Sarah says they had very different relationships with their father, Michael. She says he was much more controlling of Alyssa, but Sarah thought nothing of it for years. But in 2001, on the last day of school, Alyssa was seen leaving school early with her dad.
From there, our father says that they went out to lunch, but eventually they get into a fight. Alyssa wants more freedom over the summer, and our father says absolutely not. And our father says he last remembers seeing Alyssa walking to her bedroom angry.
But after finding a note from Alyssa saying she ran away to California, Sarah's father insisted that's what happened, and the search ended. But in 2008, Sarah was called to the Phoenix Police Department with shocking news. They believe their father had something to do with Alyssa's disappearance.
I go down there and essentially they sit me down and for 40 minutes tell me about how the man I thought he was. And then at the very end they say, you know, and because your father hasn't cooperated, because he won't interview with us, because he won't give a handwriting sample, because he won't give DNA, we are raiding your home right now. We've gotten a search warrant and we're in there.
Among the evidence, they found nearly 20 pipe bombs in a disturbing manifesto Michael wrote about how two assassins killed Alyssa. Turney was charged and sentenced to 10 years for the bombs, but got out and remains free of any charges linked to Alyssa's disappearance.
I'm like, you know, making silly stuff about Alyssa, but it catches fire. Like, my goodness, it caught wind so fast. And I never expected it, but I just continued to make content on TikTok and it continued to pick up. I mean, I have almost 1 million followers on there now, but it's been an amazing tool in getting justice for her. So our father has been the only person of interest in Alyssa's case for 10 years. The Phoenix Police Department did finally finish submitting everything that the state is asking for in terms of pressing charges. So right now it's in the hands of the state whether or not my father's going to go to trial for the murder of Alyssa.
And what do you want to happen from this? What's the ultimate goal?
Yeah, I want my father to go to trial for the murder of my sister, Alyssa.
All of his service providers are here in Arizona. He receives services at the VA as well as federal workman's comp. His physical health issues aside, I want to touch, you know, briefly on the evidence in this case or lack thereof. And while I can't speak to all of the evidence, this case is 20 years old. There is no confession, no body, no crime scene, no DNA. Mr. Turney has remained cooperative since the beginning of this case, and he has every intention to do so. He has maintained his innocence since 2000, and his intention is to see that through in court. With that being said, also, he has no failures to appear. He is willing to abide by any terms of release the court deems appropriate. Defense at this time is asking for a $25,000 to $35,000 secured appearance bond with electronic monitoring and house arrest.
I appreciate that. Anything else from defense?
What?
Nothing else, thank you.
Okay. All right. State, any response to the defense's argument?
The state's response is, Your Honor, that this is a homicide case, whether it occurred yesterday or 20 years ago. In terms of probable cause, that's already been determined by a grand jury. It's not being determined by this IA court. And the state would request that since a judicial officer at the return of the plea bill, the indictment in this case, has already determined that a $500,000 secured appearance bond in a homicide case is appropriate, the state would request that this court simply affirm that. And if defense counsel, for the reasons that she's recited to this court, believes that those are appropriate to modify the release terms on the warrant, they can certainly file a motion for modification of release terms where all of those arguments can be duly made. State has no doubt that defense counsel is representing to the best of their knowledge the situation, but at this point, the state would believe they've in no way been able to confirm his medical conditions, everything that they know, they've learned through him. So I apologize for the lengthy request, but the state believes that there should be no modification in tonight's IA release terms on a grand jury bond that was issued less than 24 hours ago. Thank you.
All right, here's my decision. Mr. Turney, I understand the age, 17 years old, I don't doubt for a second that your attorney's avowals of your health issues are evident. All right, so I am taking consideration your health issues. I am taking consideration the fact that you probably have been an upstanding citizen, not missed any court, you have ties to the community, you may not be a flight risk, but I cannot discount the information that's provided by the state. This was a grand jury indictment. It was reviewed by a grand jury. And again, he is correct. A judicial officer did make a decision, albeit 20 years ago, but it still was a decision that was made. Nothing has changed that in our eyes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to affirm the $500 security appearance bond, $500,000 security appearance bond that was issued by the grand jury with, I don't believe that I added any additional, I only added pretrial services. I don't believe he needs to be monitored electronically. He is not to possess any weapons. And he does have, and Mr. Kellerman is absolutely right. With the information that you provided this court, you will have an opportunity to present that again at future hearings. Yes, I'm going to put a motion out there to modify release conditions at a subsequent hearing. So you do have that opportunity to do that. But I'm going to affirm the $500,000 security appearance bond that was imposed by the grand jury with pretrial services upon his release. I do need to let him know that he does have court for not guilty arraignment on August 28th, 2020, 8:30 a.m. That's going to be down the street on Madison Superior Court. Those are the conditions that I've just indicated. Aside from the bond and pretrial services, there are any other additional limitations if he is able to make that bond. Does everybody understand my decision today?
The state does, Your Honor. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Judge.
You're welcome. All right, Mr. Attorney, those are your conditions. You're going to get paperwork that has all that information on it. So go ahead and step to the side and get that paperwork. And that's it for today. And good luck, sir.
Thank you.